Kway, good evening and welcome to the 2021 Symons Medal Lecture. Bonsoir et bienvenue à la médaille et causerie Symons 2021. Please join me in recognizing her honor, Lieutenant Governor Antoinette Perry. En l'honneur de notre lieutenant-gouverneur, son honneur Antoinette Perry, je vous prie de vous lever pour le salut vice-royal. Please rise for the vice-regal salute.
Contributions to our country. Previous recipients include the Right Honorable Beverly McLaughlin, Dr. David Suzuki, Professor Margaret McMillan, the Honorable Murray Sinclair, and the Honorable Bob Ray. A total of 21 recipients have been granted the award, hailing from coast to coast to coast. The Symons ceremony is held in the birthplace of Confederation to mark the anniversary of the Charlottetown Conference of 1864. Long before that historic meeting, Prince Edward Island was also known as Epigrit to the Mi'kmaq who have lived here for over 10,000 years. We proudly move forward together in the spirit of reconciliation and to continue the ongoing conversation of an evolving Canada. Since 2004, the Symons Lecture Series has provided a national platform for diverse and distinguished Canadians to share their thoughts on the current state of Confederation, giving all Canadians the opportunity to reflect upon our country and its future. Named in honor of the late Professor Thomas Symons, a visionary and founding president of Trent University, Professor Symons was widely recognized for his contributions in the areas of public policy, heritage, and education. Professor Symons has had a special relationship with Prince Edward Island for his entire life, visiting every summer since he was a teenager. He joined the board of directors of Confederation Center of the Arts in 1986 and championed heritage programming at the center for decades. Tom Symons passed away in January of 2021. And he is missed by all who knew him.
He was very humble.
He was a great guy, to say the least.
He was a very effective communicator.
When Tom spoke about something as passionately as he did, people sat up and took notice.
Tom was a builder of tradition, and you never realized you were in the center of tradition building until it happened.
Tom was always extremely engaged, an extremely active board member, contributing a lot. Genuinely interested in all the conversations. And something I noticed is how inclusive and kind he was to newcomers. He really embraced them and engaged them, always sharing stories about the history of certainly the Symons Medal, but more broadly, the history of this place and its role in celebrating Canada.
He was a dear, sweet man. A true historian, really. Takes one to know one.
We lost a great friend. We really lost a great friend.
The country and the world has lost an individual who really strive to foster understanding.
We have a unique opportunity here at the center to ensure the legacy of Tom lives on.
We'll certainly continue the Symons Medal in Tom's honor, and we're excited to establish an interpretive center on Canadian heritage. We're going to find a permanent way to tell the many stories of Canada's history from the colonial and Indigenous perspectives and really respect that tradition of what this place is here for, what it's here to celebrate. So we have a lot to give thanks for Tom.
Since Canada's Confederation, this nation has continued to evolve with a desire to become a better country, sharing her unique and international perspective on the evolution of Canadian society is this year's Symons Medal recipient, the Honourable Louise Arbour.
Please welcome to the stage the CEO of Confederation Center of the Arts, Steve Bellamy. Veuillez accueillir Steve Bellamy, directeur général du Centre des Arts de la Confédération.
Good evening, bonsoir, and welcome to the 2021 Symons Medal Lecture at Confederation Center of the Arts. Along with Her Honor Antoinette Perry, I'd like to recognize Premier Dennis King, representing the City of Charlottetown, Mayor Philip Brown, and Councillor Mike Duffy, the Honourable David Jenkins, Chief Justice of Prince Edward Island, Senator Brian Francis is with us, Senator Diane Griffin, Senator Kim Pate, and Senator Percy Downs. There are a number of elected officials and luminaries with us tonight, Confederation Center board members and staff, many important people in the room, but to save us an hour, I'm just going to thank all of you for being here with us. It means a great deal. A few weeks ago, the center started welcoming fully vaccinated folks into the center, which allows us to have people in the theater not socially distanced. Our staff thanks you for cooperating with those COVID safety protocols and reminds you to keep your mask on if you're not eating or drinking, and to please put your mask on when you're, and practice social distancing when you're not in your seat. A great number of people were involved in bringing this event here tonight. On behalf of all of them and all of us, I'd like to thank you for being here. I'd like to pay particular thanks to the Symons Committee, a volunteer committee who give their time to make this possible. I would now like to welcome to the stage the Chair of the Board of Confederation Center of the Arts and co-chair of the Symons Medal Committee, Mr. Robert Sear.
Thank you, Steve. It's so exciting to see the Confederation Center full of people once again from both on and off the island. For those of you who can be here in person, we are pleased to be live streaming across Canada in both English and French. And as we gather this evening to award the Symons Medal to the Honourable Louise Arbour, the title of Madame Arbour's lecture, DESIDERANTES, MELIOREM, PATRIAM, or They Desire a Better Country, which is the motto of the Order of Canada. It will focus on the transformation of Canadian society through immigration, the pandemic, and the law. There will be a question and answer period following the lecture, so please be thinking of some thoughtful questions while she is speaking. We invite those joining us virtually to also type questions into the video's comments section at any point during the lecture. And now, to bring greetings from the province, let's welcome our Premier, the Honourable Dennis King, to the stage.
Thank you very much, Bob. Hello, bonjour, quoi. Good evening to those Canadians who may be watching this broadcast from coast to coast to coast. Welcome to Prince Edward Island. To those of us who are fortunate to be in attendance tonight, isn't it wonderful to have the privilege to safely assemble in a large group and be together again? It certainly feels beautiful. As Premier of Prince Edward Island, it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the 20th annual Symons Lecture, brought to you by and from the Confederation Center of the Arts. The Confederation Center was established in 1965 as a national commemoration to the Fathers of Confederation. This national monument is located here in Charlottetown, the birthplace of Confederation, and we're all so very proud of it. The annual Symons Lecture and Medal presentation provides the Confederation Center and the people of Prince Edward Island an opportunity to open our doors, our hearts, and our imaginations, just like we did in 1864, to reflect on the status of our Union and to assess the prospects for this great nation of ours that we're all so very proud to call home. As I'm sure you're aware, and it was just outlined on the video before, the medal and lecture presentation are designed to honor the legacy of the late and great Tom Symons, a great Canadian, a great friend of Prince Edward Island, and a longtime supporter to the Confederation Center of the Arts. It was Tom's vision that the occasion be used to invite distinguished Canadians to thoughtfully reflect on what it means to be part of this unlikely marriage that we call Canada, that has persisted and thrived for more than a century and a half. This year's guest and medal recipient takes her place among an impressive roster of legal scholars, academics, activists, and public figures who have shared their hopes and aspirations for Canada as part of this event. We welcome Madame Louise Arbour to our province and to our stage. She has distinguished herself as both a legal scholar and a legal practitioner on both the national and international fronts. I look forward to hearing her perspective on Canada and what she sees and what she believes we can achieve. You know, one of the things that has always fascinated me is this concept of national personality, this national identity. You know, is there a national character? Is there a shared ethos, a shared system of beliefs that binds us together as people? Do nation states have personalities in the same way that individuals do? How is that an artificial boundary can build a state or union which over time gives rise to a unique and distinct political culture? And when you think about it, jurisdictions that share a language, economic systems, political systems, and even borders nonetheless develop these distinct personalities that express themselves in very singular ways. And we've witnessed that throughout the pandemic. While some jurisdictions in federal states such as ours squabbled over responsibility and authority, we here in Canada have worked together to serve the greater interest. We have shared resources, including vaccines, hospital beds, and medical personnel. We have resolved that we're all in this together, and it is only by staying together and helping each other will we actually be able to emerge from this global crisis. And my friends, that isn't by accident. It's actually by design. It's a function and it's a reflection of the principles on which our country were founded. When our founders first imagined a nation in the mid-1860s, they had the recent example of the American Civil War as a stark reminder of the consequence of an uneven distribution of power between the central government and the various states. And while the American example of intergovernmental bickering so fresh in their collective memories, our founders were careful in the allocation of powers and responsibilities. Further, they purposely chose language that was conciliatory, sharing, and forgiving. Our national ambition isn't the pursuit of happiness, but rather the achievement of peace, order, and good government. A tad bit pedestrian, boring perhaps, yet it is the national characteristic which has stood us in good stead all these years, and perhaps never more so than in these past 20 months. Thank heavens for the foresight and the prescience of our founders. Now, don't get me wrong, we've had our problems too. The pandemic and our response to it has exposed some problem areas within our federal system. In the area of healthcare, for example, which is an area of shared jurisdiction, and despite our understandable pride in the universally accessible healthcare system we have, we know improvements can and must be made. This is particularly true when you look at the areas of mental health and addictions. And I'm happy to note that in the most recent incarnation of his cabinet, Prime Minister Trudeau has recognized this fact by appointing a minister specifically responsible for this obvious public policy need. And I look forward to working with Minister Carolyn Bennett in the spirit of cooperative federalism to serve the healthcare needs of Islanders and Canadians. As I've said so many times in the past year and a half, for all that we have to be grateful for, nothing is more important than living in a country that values community. We're so very fortunate to live in a country that values collective health rather than individual wealth. And let me close with these timely and wise words from the great Canadian poet and troubadour, the late Leonard Cohen. In his poem, Democracy, Cohen writes, sail on, O mighty ship of state, to the shores of need, past the shores of greed, through the squalls of hate, sail on, sail on, sail on, and sail on we must. I look forward to Madame Arbour's lecture. May we use this time to reflect on what it means to share this citizenship, and may we never tire in our efforts to make this beautifully imperfect nation we call home that much better. With that, I say thank you, merci, well done.
Thank you, Premier King, for those very kind and thoughtful words. I will now ask Her Honor Antoinette Perry, Lieutenant Governor of Prince Edward Island, to join me for the introduction of the 2021 Symons Medallist.
Merci, Monsieur Sear. Je suis enchantée d'être ici pour présenter l'honorable Louise Arbour, l'une des expertes en droit national et international du Canada les plus respectées et les plus en demande. Maître Arbour a été nommée juge à la Cour suprême de l'Ontario en 1987, puis juge à la Cour d'appel de l'Ontario en 1990. En 1996, le Conseil de sécurité des Nations unies l'a nommée procureure en chef des tribunaux pénaux internationaux pour l'ex-Yougoslavie et le Rwanda. À ce titre, elle obtient la première condamnation pour génocide depuis la Convention de 1948 sur le génocide dans le cas du Rwanda et la première mise en accusation de tous les temps d'un chef d'État européen en fonction pour crime de guerre.
After serving at the UN as chief prosecutor for the International Criminal Tribunals, Madame Arbour was appointed to the Supreme Court of Canada in 1999. In 2004, she was appointed High Commissioner for Human Rights to the United Nations and later Special Representative of the Secretary General on international migration. Madame Arbour is a senior counsel at Borden Ladner Gervais, LLP, and currently leading an independent review into the sexual misconduct in the Canadian Armed Forces.
Ce ne sont là que quelques-uns des hauts faits d'une vie entièrement consacrée à la justice et aux droits de la personne. Tout au long de sa carrière, Maître Arbour a été reconnu pour ses contributions exceptionnelles au Canada et dans le monde. Elle est titulaire de plus de 30 diplômes honorifiques, membre de l'Ordre du Canada et lauréate du prix de la justice internationale et des droits de la personne Thomas J. Dodd.
Louise Arbour is joined tonight by her daughter, fellow human rights lawyer Emily Taman, and her granddaughter, Charlotte Spratt. We are so glad that they could be here for this very special night. And we are also pleased to present a few virtual messages of congratulations from very special guests who could not be with us tonight.
Louise Arbour is a magician. One evidence, Secretary General Guterres gives her an impossible mandate, and she got it done. She got, under President Trump, the General Assembly of the United Nations to adopt a global compact on migration. Nobody thought was feasible. That was underestimating Louise Arbour. Congratulations, Louise.
Thank you very much to the organizers of the Symons Award Medal. I'm honored and pleased to join you from the unceded, unsurrendered territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabeg. While I'm very sorry not to be able to be there in person to celebrate the awarding of the medal to the honorable, the inspirational, and the all-around brilliant, beautiful, wonderful, and amazing Louise Arbour, it is my humble privilege to send this message. When I heard the title of your talk, Louise, I thought immediately of how typically Louise-ish this was. I can hardly wait to hear your reflections on the transformation of Canadian society through immigration, the pandemic, and the law, all within the context of our individual and collective desire for a better country. Thank you for inspiring all who desire a better country, from the women at the prison for women to those who experienced unspeakable violence and relied on you to help them through, bring those responsible to justice at The Hague, to the many who appealed to and appeared before you as Justice or UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, and now for the incredible work you continue to do to support and address individual and systemic discrimination and inequity. You're such a humble, loving, kind, and compassionate person, and your legal, academic, and judicial, and international work continue to both inform and transform this country and the world. I cannot think of a more fitting recipient for this year's medal. Congratulations, thank you, merci, miigwech, Louise.
Querida Louise, I was really happy when I learned that you were going to be once again honored and recognized, as you should. It has been an immense honor to be your friend. Also a great pleasure, and also a great pleasure not only because it's pleasurable being your friend, but also because I admire enormous your wit and your sense of humor. So congratulations, you are truly a remarkable woman.
Dear Louise, congratulations on being selected to give the annual Symons Lecture. This is truly a great honor and a fitting follow-up to the many other honors and recognitions you have had in your life, and most deservedly so. Over the years, you have contributed so much in so many ways to Canada and the world. That includes the time I was privileged to serve with you on the Supreme Court of Canada. Thank you, Louise, for everything you've done. Merci beaucoup. And félicitations.
I know that Tom would have been very proud that Louise Arbour has accepted his medal. These are both people who have, and Louise's case, continue to serve the public good in Canada, and she's done so much internationally. Congratulations, Louise. This is a very important moment. We all have to remember that one of the ways the world has changed is people like Tom and Louise set to making changes possible.
Many congratulations on yet another well-deserved honor. I look forward to hearing your lecture and learning, as I have done before, from your wisdom. Again, congratulations.
Honorable Louise Arbour, Madame. Mon nom est Claude Mitra, de la ville de Sherbrooke, dans les cantons de l'Est de la province de Québec. Sur la recommandation de l'honorable Jean Charest, le Conseil de mai 2004 du Conseil exécutif du gouvernement de l'île du Prince-Édouard me faisait membre à titre de délégué du Québec au comité des fiduciaires du Centre des arts de la Confédération et de ses comités. De plus, en avril 2018, je recevais la médaille d'or du lieutenant-gouverneur du Québec, l'honorable Michel J. Doyon. Aujourd'hui, je me joins aux membres du comité de la conférence, Tom Symon, pour vous souhaiter la plus cordiale bienvenue comme 21e récipiendaire de la médaille souvenir et invité comme conférencière sur un thème de votre choix. Votre carrière exceptionnelle, en plus de vos nombreux titres, ajoute à la liste prestigieuse de vos prédécesseurs et contribue à la reconnaissance nationale du Centre des arts de la Confédération et du comité de la conférence. J'ai pris connaissance du résumé de votre parcours et des plus importants sur tous les postes que vous avez occupés et ceux qui sont encore pleins d'actualité. Je retiens avec une certaine fierté que vous êtes compagnon de l'Ordre du Canada, grand officier de l'Ordre national du Québec. Avec ce mot de bienvenue, j'anticipe l'honneur et le privilège de vous rencontrer. Bienvenue, Honorable Louise Arbour.
Heartfelt congratulations, Louise, on receiving the 21st Symons Medal. You are my intellectual hero, mentor, and friend. And I've really missed your piercing intellect and voice of reason, and I really can't wait to hear you speak today.
Louise Arbour is an icon for the rule of law and for the protection of the rule of law in Canada and the world. She brings critical firsthand experience to the Confederation Center of the Arts main stage. She is a wonderful communicator. Her service as chief prosecutor of the International Criminal Tribunal in the former Yugoslavia was pivotal in the historic indictment of a sitting head of state. A lawyer, jurist, and international statesperson, Louise Arbour is a beacon for democracy. She knows of the dangerous forces of autocrats and dictators in an ever dangerous world around us. The Symons Medal and Lecture Series is really honored by the presence of our 2021 medalist. Louise Arbour is singularly well situated to bring a valuable and timely international perspective on the state of Canadian Confederation. Congratulations and welcome, Louise.
Félicitations, Louise. Louise, congratulations. You are a worthy recipient of the Symons Medal. He was a wonderful Canadian, and so are you.
It's my great pleasure to join in this tribute for Louise Arbour. I've had the great honor of giving the Symons Lecture myself, and when I heard that Louise was going to be the honoree this year, I was totally delighted. There's so many ways in which I respect, love, admire, and have done my best, though never meeting her standards, to emulate the remarkable career of Louise Arbour, her enormous contribution to Canada and to the world in the field of human rights, migration, accountability, justice. So many ways in which she's been such a wonderful representative of Canada and everything that she's done. And I'm so proud to not only be her admirer, but also to be her friend. And Louise, I'm just thrilled that you're receiving this award today.
And now, Confederation Center of the Arts is proud to present the 2021 Symons Medal to the Honourable Louise Arbour.
Dear friends, all protocol observed. I've learned that expression from the Secretary General of the United Nations, who was always very keen not to spend half his speech acknowledging all the excellencies in the room, and I think deep down was petrified that he might forget one, which could put a dent in his career. So he used that formula, all protocol observed, which... After all these amazing tributes, I feel I should maybe just take this little speech and go home, because I'm afraid there's no way I could live up to the expectations that these liars may have created. On the other hand, I'm quite happy that my granddaughter is here today, will be able to take home to her brothers the fact that grandmama is really impressive. I'm very grateful to the board members of the Confederation Center for allowing me to join the list of these eminent Canadians who've been honored in the past 20 years as recipients of the Symons Medal. They represent a wide spectrum of this, at times, very puzzling country. Contrary to many of them, I didn't know Tom Symons personally, but I really hope that I'll be able to do justice to his memory tonight by trying to project into the future his vision for a country to which he gave so much. I have entitled my remarks today, Desiderantes Meliorem Patriam. I did a lot of Latin when I was in school. They desire a better country. And I'll explain later a little bit why I chose this title. But suffice it to say that Tom Symons very much desired a better country and inspired the many who have walked in his footsteps. When I was working as a judge, I was always conscious of the fact that our take on things starts always from a point of view, and no one can claim to have the universal one. Of course, like many of my colleagues on the bench, I've learned to strive to develop an objective and impartial point of view, which I think is a critical endeavor for a judge, but I don't operate under such constraints tonight. So I simply want to stress that the reflections that I propose to share with you are intensely personal. I feel very privileged to have had the opportunity to work on a great variety of issues in lots of different environments. I have no other ambition today than to share with you a few ideas that are rooted in my life and work through times of change and the promise of even greater change to come. Not surprisingly, it's in my international work that the issue of perspective and point of view has been the most glaringly apparent. Just as an example, in 2010, I was the recipient of what is called the North-South Prize of the Council of Europe. This prize is awarded, I think, every second year, usually to a man and a woman, one from the North and one from the South. And I shared the prize that year with President Lula da Silva of Brazil. Needless to say, he represented the South, I the North. Now, this geographic view of the world is, of course, the reverse image of the view from within Canada. There was something weird in my, quote, representing the North. In my Canadian eyes, I'm not from the North, and the North is not viewed as the wealthy one. In the same way, when I started teaching law at Osgoode Hall Law School in the mid-1970s, my English was far from fluent, and my thinking was still mostly in French. So when I was teaching criminal procedure, in English, of course, some of the women in my class thought that I was a master of the use of feminist political language. Because when I referred to the police, I always said she. And the same for the crown. And the same for the defense, the court. I used she every time, evoking, they thought, a female office holder. Now, of course, in French, these words are all feminine. La police, la défense, la couronne, la cour. Actually, only the accused was always he. Since, as it happens most of the time, he is, but also in French, it's masculine. This brings me to my first reflection about our country, a very personal one, as I said. I was born in Montreal. I was raised by my mother, who had to wait until 1968 to obtain a divorce, since before then, you had to get a private act of parliament to do so, a little over the top, if you ask me. I was in boarding school for several years, and I obtained my BA in that homogeneous Catholic girls' college operated by nuns. My view of the world was therefore informed by strong, capable, independent, educated women in an environment in which men were almost totally absent. Law school in 1967 felt, at that time, quite a liberating experience, a long overdue exposure to the larger world. It was the year of Expo, where I managed to land a job by pretending to speak English. Not a job on the site of the World Exhibition with direct exposure to the public, since without then the protection of anti-discrimination law, it seems that I didn't meet the height requirements. to be a hostess in the Canadian Pavilion. I worked as a telephone operator. The whole world had come to visit. We had a brand new subway, which made hitchhiking less necessary in town, but still quite handy on the side of the highway to get around the Gaspé Peninsula. Another era altogether. Moving to English Canada in the early 70s, first to clerk at the Supreme Court of Canada for Justice Pigeon, and then to start teaching at Osgoode Hall Law School a few years later, was, in retrospect, without doubt, the biggest cultural shock I've ever experienced. When I went to work for the United Nations some years later, I expected to have to make some cultural adjustments. Needless to say, work in international human rights, particularly the field work, brought me to very exotic foreign places where I shared neither the language nor much else, really, with most of the people with whom I interacted. So why was it that Canada, my country, could have felt so alien when I first moved out of my zone of comfort? And why did the feeling take so long to dissipate, even though I lived and worked in Toronto for more than 25 years, and to this day I continue to work as much in English as in French? And isn't it part of the way we all feel as we are confronted, late, but increasingly so, with our pre-Confederation history and our shameful interface with those who were there before us? And who is us, anyway? Tout ceci m'amène à réfléchir aux notions d'identité et d'appartenance qui m'ont toujours intéressée et qui sont essentielles au projet canadien. Bien que la question soit d'une douloureuse actualité, je ne vais pas revenir aujourd'hui sur les questions qui touchent aux peuples autochtones, questions qui ont fait l'objet de la remarquable conférence prononcée ici même par l'honorable sénateur Murray Sinclair en 2019. Mes travaux en ex-Yougoslavie et au Rwanda, au lendemain des guerres fratricides qui les ont déchirées, m'ont confronté aux pires pathologies de l'appartenance et ont alimenté ma réflexion sur la gestion de la diversité aux prises avec son bagage historique, géographique et politique. Je vais donc vous inviter à réfléchir avec moi sur l'avenir de notre pays, un pays dans lequel l'histoire et la géographie sont parfois en compétition. Vu par le reste du monde, le Canada est souvent défini par sa géographie, beaucoup moins par son histoire. Une vaste étendue froide, peuplée par des espèces d'Américains du Nord. Et si ce grossier stéréotype vous semble exagéré, on n'a qu'à se référer à l'image qu'on a nous-mêmes des pays qu'on n'a jamais visités, que ce soit la Chine, la Russie ou la Bolivie, pour comprendre que les stéréotypes sont parfois inévitables. Vu de l'intérieur, la géographie joue encore une place que certains diront disproportionnée dans l'organisation de la gouvernance au Canada. Par exemple, au-delà des exigences constitutionnelles, l'attribution des 9 sièges à la Cour suprême du Canada, vous vous souviendrez, il y en a 3 qui sont requis pour le Québec, 3 qui sont traditionnellement attribués à l'Ontario, 2 aux provinces de l'Ouest et 1 siège aux provinces des Maritimes. Cet arrangement relève à la fois de l'histoire et de la géographie. Mais les contraintes imposées par cette répartition sont de plus en plus souvent confrontées aux attentes d'un Canada moderne, dans lequel ces deux notions, géographie, histoire, laissent beaucoup moins de place à d'autres considérations. L'attention accrue dans les dernières années à la nécessité d'une vraie diversité dans la composition de la Cour, témoigne d'une évolution de la conception même que l'on se fait du Canada, une conception de plus en plus centrée sur les personnes et sur les cultures. This evolution was facilitated by the advent of the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms in 1982. Previous constitutional debates had centered, of course, on federalism and the distribution of powers under the British North America Act, which actually reminds me of an old joke about international students. Some of you may have heard that one at the time. These international students were asked to write an essay about love. So the French student wrote a thesis that was all about the perfect French lover. An American kid wrote about love and happy endings in Hollywood movies. A bunch of Scandinavian students wrote about love and the sexual revolution in the 60s, but the Canadian student was stuck, having a lot of trouble starting on his thesis entitled Love, Whether Federal or Provincial Jurisdiction. Not that we have abandoned altogether our addiction to debating the structures of our federal system, but the Charter, I think, has shifted the conversation to people, to individual rights and universal standards. This brings me to who we are today, as a people living in a constitutional democracy, affected historically by the challenges of managing our differences, and I believe increasingly so in the future, by the transformative effect of immigration, now anchored in a culture of rights. The wave of anti-foreigners, particularly anti-Muslim sentiments, that submerged most of the Western world after the attacks on the World Trade Center some 20 years ago, followed by the more recent so-called migration crisis on the doorsteps of Europe, the Brexit movement, the rise of extreme right rhetoric, and the apparent increased attraction of authoritarianism, all of these have contributed to a negative portrayal of immigration that I believe must be and can be overtaken by a different, much more positive approach, at least in this country. This is not based on the periodic outpour of generosity that expresses itself in the face of unbelievable hardship, triggered, I think, for instance, this time, by the sentiment that we have abandoned the people of Afghanistan. I think when we look at newcomers, wherever they're coming from, we are conscious that we are looking into the future. For one thing, the absolute necessity of turning to migratory input to offset our demographic deficits will become increasingly apparent as labor shortages continue to plague our economy. At the same time, the so-called pushes and pulls that compel people to migrate will continue to increase, particularly in the face of the growing combined effects of climate change and income inequalities. I feel very privileged to have had an opportunity to work with the UN Secretary General on the Global Compact for Migration, which was adopted by UN member states at the end of 2018. It was for me an eye-opener into an issue that is at the heart of the future of this country as much as it has played an important part in its past. International migration calls into play economic, legal, political, and cultural consideration. It is subjected to popular opinions, myths, and stereotypes. It invites debates that bring to the surface not always rational, but real, even if misguided, fears about the preservation and the nurturing of national identities. The work I've done internationally, particularly in the United Nations human rights system, has reinforced my conviction that the values expressed in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights continue to hold the very best promise for a fair, secure, and prosperous world. These values have been embraced with different degrees of convictions by most Western countries, including Canada, particularly since the advent of the Charter. Not surprisingly, I believe that we must work vigilantly to protect and indeed to advance these modern ideals and ideas of equality, fairness, respect for individual rights and freedoms. But here as elsewhere, in my opinion, the greatest threat to Western values is not an influx in our country of people who may not share these values today. It's the hypocrisy of those claiming to protect these values and then repudiating them by their actions. This disconnect between rhetoric and action has gone a long way to fuel the pushback against the international human rights agenda. I think this surfaced very clearly in the debate surrounding the adoption of the Global Compact for Migration. Faced with a sudden influx of refugees, many actually were forced to flee regions that the West had contributed to destabilize, think of Iraq or Libya, in particular, Europeans were for the first time asked to do something that was hard for them to do. And yet, it's not with a lot of hesitation that they had pressured others for years to do something that was equally hard for them to do, such as repudiating entrenched cultural practices at a pace dictated by others. This actually mirrored the very uncomfortable position that Canada found itself in when it voted against the adoption of the Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples by the United Nations General Assembly in 2007. Walking away from a text that had been decades in preparation, a process in which Canada had actively participated, was seen by many as another example of Western hypocrisy. I believe that this setback considerably Canada's effort to promote other important issues such as women and LGBT rights through Canada's development agenda. The disconnect between advocacy of affirmed values and the protection of perceived interest was blatant and embarrassing. Fortunately, in 2016, Canada reversed that position, and earlier this year, legislation was passed to implement the provisions of the Declaration. Yet, if there is one issue on which Canada shines internationally way beyond and above what most Canadians may realize, it's on the issue of international migration. Canada, even more so than the United States, which still remains a destination of choice for many, is viewed as the ultimate country of destination success story. Tout au moins jusqu'au jour où des images du chemin Roxham ont commencé à circuler dans les médias, le Canada était perçu comme une terre d'accueil bien gérée, accueillante et attirante, tant pour les réfugiés que pour les migrants soi-disant économiques. Je souligne le mot soi-disant parce que cette appellation, comme beaucoup de choix de vocabulaire, occulte la multiplicité des causes qui poussent les gens à quitter leur pays, souvent dans des circonstances où ils ont aussi peu de choix que les demandeurs d'asile, mais pour des raisons qui ne sont pas reflétées dans la Convention sur les réfugiés. Cette convention, issue des horreurs de la Deuxième Guerre mondiale, offre sa protection aux personnes qui fuient la persécution politique, la guerre, mais comme la plupart des instruments juridiques conçus par les Occidentaux vainqueurs de cette guerre, la Convention ne reflète pas les droits économiques et sociaux qui sont pourtant exprimés aussi clairement dans la Déclaration universelle des droits de l'homme. Les migrants qui fuient non pas la guerre, mais qui fuient la misère, la faim, la corruption, l'absence de soins de santé, le manque d'avenir pour leurs enfants, et qui ne cherchent qu'à contribuer à construire une société juste et équitable, ces migrants, qu'on appelle alors des migrants économiques, sont souvent perçus comme des gens qui avaient le choix et donc qui n'étaient pas persécutés dans leur pays et auxquels on ne doit rien. Pourtant, ce sont eux, tout comme les réfugiés au sens de la Convention, qui ont contribué à bâtir le Canada moderne. Our history of immigration is undeniably a success story, and there's nothing today to suggest that it shouldn't and wouldn't continue to be so. Those who, like many of us, have won the geographic lottery at birth have no reason to believe that this was the result of any particular merit or entitlement on their part, and it's therefore very difficult to understand why some are so adverse to sharing in what they refer to as their birthright. I'm aware that the fear of an influx of foreigners will transform our social fabric in undesirable ways. That fear is not new. It has emerged, mixed with different degrees of hostility in response to the arrival of most newcomers, despite the repeated success of their integration and contributions. The reality is that our social fabric is changing anyway. In this increasingly interconnected world, we have a choice. We could look to the past, romanticize it, and stagnate in isolation. Or we can embrace a future in which our children will develop their own culture, open to that of others, inspired by the choices we are making today. The only walls that will stop the human quest for a better future are the walls that we erect in our minds. And it's our own future that we imprison, I think, when we hide behind the barbed wires of exclusion. This brings me back to the title of my remarks today. Many of the Canadians who've been honored in this venue were the recipients of the Order of Canada. This is in part why I've chosen to entitle my remark, "They Desire a Better Country," which of course is the motto of the Order of Canada. Because I believe that this motto, "They Desire a Better Country," is equally applicable to the hundreds of thousands of refugees and immigrants who have knocked on our doors over the years. They too desired a better country. Actually, most of them desired their country of origin to be a better one, in which they could continue to live and thrive and contribute. But when that became impossible, they chose us, as they desired a better country. And they continue to contribute immensely, individually and collectively, to make us so. What is maybe less well known is how much immigrants also continue to contribute to make their country of origin a better country long after they've left. However invested in their adoptive countries, diasporas play a critical role in the ongoing development of their country of origin. One only has to look at the massive impact of remittances to understand the significance of this contribution. Migrants regularly send money to their families left behind. The aggregate of these small sums, called remittances, that are sent home, particularly to poor countries, represent, in total, three times the total amount of official international development aid provided by rich countries to developing ones. According to the World Bank, in 2018, overall global remittances grew by 10% to $689 billion, including $528 billion to developing countries. Despite all the objective evidence pointing to the positive aspects of migration, the early response to newcomers, here as elsewhere, is often one of distrust and rejection. But it's over time, and increasingly through deliberate policies aimed at inclusion, that the full benefits of migration come to be realized, often to the benefit of the second generation of migrants through the sacrifices of their parents. The international effort to better regulate human mobility through the adoption of the Global Compact on Migration in 2018 was tested in the most unpredictable way by the onset of the COVID-19 global pandemic. The pandemic, which has dominated our lives now for more than a year and a half, has brought to the surface like never before the interconnectedness of the modern world. A public health emergency quickly engulfed the planet, testing even the capacity of sophisticated healthcare systems in the most developed countries, propelling science to the forefront of public debate, and overshadowing virtually all other issues everywhere. Even more so than international terrorism a few decades earlier, the pandemic was also about borders, isolation, and fear. It was also once again, and dramatically so, about trusting our governments to find the right balance between our desire to be safe and our right to be free, or put differently, between our right to be safe and our desire to be free. The big difference, however, I think, between the so-called war on terror and the fight against the pandemic is that this time we are all of us, all at once, possible victims and possible perpetrators. Wearing a mask, ostensibly to protect ourselves, is actually designed to protect others. Then, therefore, the us and them is a lot less clear this time than it was, for instance, at the outset of the war on terror, when it had been a lot easier to vilify a perceived common enemy. This time, the enemy was the virus itself, not the carriers, at least until some forces of disunity attempted to realign allegiances, nurturing distrust and yielding nothing to the common good. But so far, few have succeeded, beyond their pre-existing echo chambers, and we have remained as a society, if not globally, profoundly engaged in a common project. The pandemic has therefore provided us with a necessary fresh look at the challenges that will come from climate change, at our dependence and reliance on science, at questions of personal choices and collective responsibility. It has fostered debates about utopic ideals of closed doors and self-sufficiencies. It has given rise to absurd conspiracy theories and has even branded as attractive autocratic leaders that some would like to trust, therefore saving themselves for having to make difficult personal moral choices. It has lifted the curtain on the people who work in essential services, and we discovered there not only migrant workers, but many undocumented migrants, very vulnerable people tasked with protecting all of us when we were ourselves at our most vulnerable. As we came to appreciate what services are truly essential to our collective well-being, who's providing these services, to whom, and under what circumstances, an unprecedented shift of attention has taken place, highlighting the needs of our aging population and the likely source of service providers who will take on that charge in the years ahead. So at the crossroads of the issues related to the pandemic and immigration, it could have been expected that the intuitive reaction of closing borders would have played against any opening of minds towards progressive immigration policies. But the pandemic made very readily apparent the difference between tourism and immigration, between essential and discretionary travel, and the continued imperative on relying on others, broadly defined, for our own survival. In fact, I believe that the pandemic has propelled us into a new era in which bold political choices will be more, not less, necessary and feasible. The sacrifices that we've had to make have opened our eyes to our ability to adapt, to live differently, to change. As I contemplate the possibilities for progress and the likelihood of fundamental change, I can only turn to the extraordinary advances in my own primary professional discipline, the law. There's no doubting the role that the law can play in either freezing old norms or, on the contrary, propelling reforms. In the civil law system under which I was trained, the status of married women remained until 1964 akin to that of minors and of persons stripped of their legal capacity. Women in my own province of Quebec did not obtain the right to vote until 1940, and not for lack of trying. At that time, I believed that the law was trailing way behind social mores, and that both legislators and judges, almost exclusively men, were at odds with the changing world, particularly as that change was accelerated after the Second World War. In contrast, when gender equality was entrenched in the Constitution in 1982, the legal enforceable requirement of equality opened the door to a range of courtroom victories for women's rights, which transformed the reality of women's lives in significant ways and opened the path to reform for many other equality-seeking groups. The newly acquired audacity of judges relying on constitutional imperatives to bring the whole country to live up to its stated values and principles, that didn't go unchallenged. And yet the claims of judicial activism, of the legalization of politics, of governance by unelected tyrants, have not succeeded, I believe, in eroding the confidence of Canadians in their courts. This is particularly remarkable since this confidence doesn't seem to rest on the popularity of the outcome of any particular judicial decision. Indeed, in vindicating rights, the Supreme Court has often found itself appearing to side with unpopular minorities or having to put an end to an intractable public debate on heavily polarized issues. It's not by sheer luck that we've avoided the politicization apparent in the United States court system and the inevitable consequent loss of public confidence. And I think here it's really interesting to reflect on the impact of culture on process. When it comes, for instance, to judicial appointments, on paper, I think the UN system for the selection of Supreme Court justices, on paper, would appear vastly superior to the Canadian one. In the US, there's a public, transparent process engaging both the executive and the legislative branch with great media scrutiny on the merits of each proposed candidate. This would appear, it seems to me, vastly preferable to the slightly more opaque, seemingly unilateral executive process that was the Canadian system, at least until very recently, and frankly, which still commands very little public interest and debate. And yet, in my view, the reality is exactly the opposite. Political forces in the US have managed to transform that procedure into a visibly partisan process where merit is set aside in favor of political maneuvers, blatantly interested in serving party political and ideological interest. In contrast, the vast discretion imparted to prime ministers in the Canadian system seems to have induced most of them to work prudently to preserve that privilege by exercising it in the public interest and avoiding the appearance of making nakedly partisan appointments. The tone, as much as the content of court decision, I think also goes a long way in reinforcing public confidence in the judicial system. Faced with the need to express their conclusions in a convincing manner and to address opposing views, judges, particularly those who operate in a collegial forum, like in appellate courts, have been well advised in this country to write in accessible language and speak in a respectful voice. Belligerent and dismissive rejoinders with colleagues only fuel an atmosphere of conflict that reflects and risks perpetuating the confrontational approach of the parties. We have therefore, I think, every reason to celebrate, and we must be vigilant to preserve the integrity of our judicial system. Allow me to refer to what I said to an audience of Pakistani lawyers and judges in Lahore several years ago. This was at the height of terrible tensions between lawyers and judges, between the bench and the bar. I said, the enforceability of court's decision rests for the most part on compliance, not on coercion. No judicial system could operate on coercion alone. When the judge walks into the courtroom, for example, if the audience refuses to rise, the judge, of course, could cite members of the audience for contempt of court and even sentence them to prison. But if the next day and the day after that, a new audience still refuses to rise as a show of respect for the court, will the judges eventually try to imprison the whole country to establish their authority and their power? The preservation of public trust is therefore essential to the proper administration of justice, and that in turn is essential to the proper functioning of democratic governance under the rule of law. This is a system in which citizens can turn with confidence to the court for the resolution of their disputes, including their disputes with the state itself. The day the audience doesn't stand up when the judge enters the courtroom, in fact or metaphorically, is the beginning of the end of judicial power. And in a properly functional judicial system, people rise for the court not because they're afraid, not even because they will necessarily agree with the decision in the case at bar, but because they respect the process and agree to yield to the authority of the court. I'm not sure that my admonition had much impact on my Pakistani fellow lawyers and judges, but I do remain persuaded of the value of living under the rule of law and of the important part that the judicial system plays in that. So let me conclude by saying a few words about the rule of law. It's a very rich legal concept, both powerful and dangerous at the same time. It's dangerous because if it's reduced to the idea of rule by law, laws that are oblivious to their content, it can be a very powerful tool in the hands of authoritarian regimes who like nothing better than law enforcement on their own terms. This was, in fact, the hallmark of Nazi Germany, a rules-based, oppressive, and murderous regime. In contrast, a proper understanding of the rule of law as a pillar of democratic constitutional governance requires that it be infused with content. Not only is it imperative that laws be properly and publicly enacted, that they apply to everyone, that they be understandable and capable of being complied with, but they must be demonstrably just laws. This was expressed, I think, with great clarity in the preamble of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which reads as follows: whereas it's essential, if man is not to be compelled to have recourse as a last resort to rebellion against tyranny and oppression, that human rights should be protected by the rule of law. The rule of law, as endorsed in the Canadian Constitution, requires just that. It ensures to all people equal protection and equal benefit of the law without discrimination, and it constrains the state not to infringe on the life, liberty, and security of individuals. Without such well-defined substantive content, the rule of law becomes an empty shell, dangerously useful to provide an appearance of legitimacy to the most oppressive state practices. In fact, I've never found a better expression of the rule of law than that that was expressed by Henri-Dominique Lacordaire, who was a leading Dominican priest in the 19th century, and he said, "Between the rich and the poor, between the master and the servant, between the strong and the weak, it is freedom that oppresses and the law that sets free." So as long as we continue to invest in this very simple but rich understanding of the rule of law, I have no doubt that those desiring a better country will continue to find it right here. Thank you very much for your kind attention and your generous hospitality.
Thank you so much for that inspired lecture and for sharing your considerable experience with us. We have invited the Honourable David Jenkins, Chief Justice of Prince Edward Island, to respond and express our gratitude to you. David?
Oh, where to start? Dear friends and honored guests, bonsoir, quay, good evening. It's my privilege to respond on your behalf to the Honorable Louise Arbour's presentation. I wish to reflect briefly on our Symons Medallist and her lecture, mostly about her, because she has given the message to us so well, but also to express her thanks. J'ai le plaisir ce soir de prononcer quelques mots à la suite de l'exposé de notre conférencier pour lui offrir le remerciement de l'orateur. Mette Arbour, votre exposé à la causerie Symons sur la tête de la Confédération abordait ce sujet très provocateur avec beaucoup de propos et d'habileté. Merci. The Symons Medal Lecture provides a forum through which leading Canadians can publicly share their view on the state of Canadian Confederation. Louise Arbour is singularly equipped by her vast direct experience and her public service to bring a perspective on Canada and its place in the world. She served on the front line, both in Canada and internationally. She is an excellent communicator. We know that Thomas H.B. Symons, who sadly passed away, but whose shining legacy lives on, would be delighted this evening. In a very personal way, Louise Arbour has shared with us how she is the product of her time and place of birth in Canada. Born and raised in Montreal as a French Canadian, a woman, professionally trained, she emerged in the late 1960s and the early 70s. In those days, law school and the practice of law was a male domain. Across the country, less than 5% of law students, were female. She became a trailblazer by necessity. She quickly found her way, chosen to clerk at the Supreme Court of Canada, and then on to Toronto, which was then a very English place. With all the challenges throughout her amazing 50-year career, and she mentioned this a little bit this evening, she described transferring in the 1970s from French civil law Quebec into English common law Ontario as the biggest hurdle that she ever had to overcome to succeed in her law career. Her next move from Canadian law to academe and then to the international human rights front is really dramatic and sounds even more daunting. With humility and selflessness, Louise Arbour readily accepted invitations. First, she became chief prosecutor of the International Criminal Tribunals in the former Yugoslavia and Somalia. There, she put herself directly into harm's way, into the crossfire of battle. She prosecuted tyrants in a cruel and dangerous world where sometimes powerful governments who are supposed to protect people are the actual offenders. And she achieved a lot. Heading a staff of over 500, she secured the first ever conviction for war crimes of a sitting head of state, and then the first conviction for genocide since the post-war Nuremberg trials. For a full appreciation of her speaker's signal qualifications to bring her message, chronology is important. So I'll just mention that after 3 years in The Hague, in 1999, the Prime Minister appointed Louise Arbour to the Supreme Court of Canada. Now, this is traditionally a life appointment, and yet, less than 5 years in, and sitting at the pinnacle of influence in Canadian law, with her reputation for excellence and clear writing already established, Louise Arbour ventured right back into the international fray. In 2004, she readily accepted the plea of the Secretary General of the United Nations to become the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights. The incumbent had just been killed in a bombing in Iraq. She left behind her secure, prestigious, and promising seat on the Supreme Court of Canada for the front line of the crossfire in the battle for human rights. I didn't make this up, it's on a YouTube video that I saw. But you can see it too. Louise Arbour persisted as an activist high commissioner. She led the UN into previously off-limit fields of horror. Recall the Darfur genocide in the Sudan and the LRA in northern Uganda. With a singular firmness, measured with diplomacy, Louise Arbour charged forward, promoting and protecting human rights. This was dangerous and clearly unpopular with many of the most powerful world leaders near and afar. Her response, she said, "My job is to protect human rights for everyone, all the time, everywhere. If the consequence is that I've made more enemies than friends, then so be it. That's what I'm supposed to be." Flash forward to 2017, Louise Arbour served internationally yet again. This time she was the special representative of the UN Secretary General for International Migration. In all these missions, she saw atrocities and their effects, refugees and the underlying causes and drivers for emigration from other countries and territories and for immigration into Canada. She knows the dangers of human rights abuses in other places. She is uniquely positioned to share her hands-on experience and reflect in her lecture as to the essential underpinning provided by the rule of law to protect democracy from tyranny. Our speaker appreciates the fears and concerns of many established Canadians that give rise to caution and hesitation toward newcomers, but also the greater potential for a better country from well-constructed immigration policies. She understands that democracy is fragile and how Canada is an oasis, the best hope for so many people. So we are privileged this evening. We're a privileged audience because only Louise Arbour could deliver this particular message, and she has delivered with such grace. Our speaker candidly shared her opinion of our mosaic and who we are today. And she said in her speech a moment ago, Canadians today are a people living in a constitutional democracy, affected historically by the challenges of managing our differences, and increasingly so for the future by the transformative effect of immigration, now anchored in a culture of rights. That's a lot to get around, and it's a lot said. These themes are intertwined. There are challenges. There is great hope for the future, and it all depends on a broad acceptance and diligent adherence to the rule of law, marked by mutual respect among the three branches of government, the legislative, the executive, and the judicial, to maintain proper separation of power, the continuing guarantee of rights and freedoms of individual persons, sometimes unpopular in the face of the popular view, an open-minded, compassionate, and balanced immigration policy. Desiderantes, Meliorem, Patriam, they desire a better country. Elles espèrent patrie meilleure. This is the motto of the Order of Canada, recipients of this highest medal of merit. They desire a better country. So too do immigrants, newcomers to Canada, who come looking for a better future, desiring to contribute to Canada becoming a better country. We all of us here, we all desire a better country. Our friend, Louise Arbour, reminds us that we have reason to be glad we are Canadian and that we need to be vigilant to protect our institutions of government and human rights so as to validate this hope and confidence. Honourable Louise Arbour, congratulations and thank you for sharing with us with candor, warmth and eloquence your reflections informed by your lifetime of achievement as a leading Canadian jurist and international war crimes prosecutor, human rights protector, and statesperson. Merci beaucoup, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Chief Justice. Madame Arbour will return in a moment. We're just preparing the stage now for the question and answer period. If you would like to ask a question, please line up socially distant at the nearest microphone, and I will call upon you. Please keep your mask on while speaking into the microphone, and if you're watching online, you can ask a question in the chat.
Now let's invite our medalist back out. We will kick things off with a question submitted online, shared by the center's communications manager, Emily McMahon.
Great, thanks, Bob. We have lots of people joining us online tonight. This question comes from Fraser on YouTube. Louise, with regards to the UN's responsibility to protect doctrine, what role should Canada serve towards Afghanistan in the years ahead? We're starting off big, folks.
I thought the idea was we were going to start with the easy ones and just kind of so I could warm up. Well, Canada has played, I think, a really important role in Afghanistan. The Canadian Armed Forces have made an amazing contribution throughout, I think, years of efforts, not only to secure the environment, but to open up the country towards democratic ideals, and in particular, to advance the situation of women and girls in Afghanistan. So I think, not for me to dictate the foreign policy of Canada going forward, but after this kind of investment, and I think of public opinion investment, one only has to hope that Canada will remain engaged. I think part of the dilemma, I'm very conscious of it, is how to interact and interface with regimes with which we appear at least to have very little in common. It's a very real dilemma in the current world. But in this particular case, I think engagement is critical. We cannot have invested so much and made so many friends in that country to just walk away from it at one of the times of their greatest need. So I think certainly on the development front, and on the critically needed humanitarian assistance that I think is there to be seen. We can only hope that Canada will remain a leading player.
Thank you very much. We're going to take a few questions from the audience now, and we'll take our first one from this young lady on my left. Please go ahead.
Great. Hi, my name is June. And my question is, as a female grade 8 student, I found that my school dress code is on the sexist side of things, and I was wondering what your opinion on dress codes is, specifically from a women's point of view, and if there are any connections you can make to the current state of the military.
Should I answer now? Or take yes. Okay. I have to tell you something about dress codes. I mentioned in my remarks that I grew up and I was educated in Quebec in what was originally was called a convent school, and then it became a classical college as it evolved. So I was in that institution from grade 6 until the end of my BA. So I was there for 10 years wearing a uniform. And when I graduated and went to law school, I swore I would never, ever, ever wear a uniform ever again. And then, some 20 years later, I became a judge and I wore a uniform. The lesson being, never make promises that you may not be able to keep. Frankly, I think the uniform made more sense for judges than I felt it made for me at the time, but on the other hand, there was something about it that was a great equalizer. Certainly for a judge, it's a way, I think, to a large extent, and that's where it makes sense in that environment, and less so for maybe school children, is that for a judge, it makes very clear that it's not about you. It's not your personal views that matter. It's your contribution to the development of the law. You're part of a community, as I said, it's not about you. I think in an education environment, the desire to explore your personality and your interaction with the world by the way you dress and express yourself is something that I personally would want to nurture, but I know there are different views. I don't know.
Thank you again.
And as for the military, maybe let me just add one thing. I won't say much because I'm currently working with the Canadian Armed Forces and looking at issues there, and I'll reserve all my opinions for when I finish this work next spring. But I can't help but mention to you that, as you know, the military is the kind of the universe of uniforms. And I mentioned to some of my interlocutor in the Canadian Armed Forces that the difference, one of the many differences, I thought, between military people wearing a uniform and judges is that judges, particularly in the early days when they were all men, when they came to the court and were given a uniform, their uniform is called a robe, which I think was good. It sends a signal that it's not all about macho power.
Thank you very much. We're going to move to the other side of the theater and question from this lady here, please.
Good evening. Thank you so much for the learning that you've provided this opportunity to us tonight. I have a two-part question for you that's coming from the perspective, as you spoke, about immigration and certainly inclusion and diversity and equity. Do you feel it's time to review and perhaps delete old policies and legislation that hinder our ability and understanding or even our pathways and ability to come together and work together, as they represent, of course, a process across time and space that may no longer represent where we're going? And part two, if we're successful in being in relation with one another in an equitable way, despite our differences, of course, wanting for others what we would want for ourselves, maybe a home, a job, a friend, will we also not be transforming our very health and well-being, indeed maybe our mental health, and having housing first for all as a scaffold to all else, and the true and necessary understanding moving forward that we are the medicine for one another?
How can I say anything beyond echoing your words? I mean, in terms of changing legislations and policies, I think what I mentioned in my speech, when I say we live in a constitutional democracy, I think all parts have a role to play. We elect our governments, they speak of their ideals, their views, their platforms, and of course, they're elected in a majoritarian system. And at the same time, certainly since 1982 in particular, we have constitutional constraints on the directions that the popular opinion may want to take, particularly when it comes to the protection of those for whom an electoral system does not provide a sufficient voice, particularly very unpopular minorities. I've worked in the past on prisoners' issues. I did some work with some of my friends who are here tonight on the prison for women. This is where I think the checks and balances, the constraints that the Constitution places on the will of the majority, disrespecting the fundamental human rights of unpopular minority, this is the system in which I think we can invest in advancing a plurality of interests, common, widely shared interests, and also fundamental respect for those whose voice is not as loud and not heard, I think, in purely electoral environments. And I should add in particular that I'm very happy that, at least in my lifetime, we see an increasing interest in what are called economic and social rights. You know, I referred to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It has, on the one hand, civil and political rights, but also economic and social rights. And Western countries, historically, were a lot more interested in these civil and political rights, you know, their freedom of speech and, you know, the makings of democracy. But I think historically felt that economic and social rights would be the inevitable kind of benevolent benefits of a free market society. Well, I think it has proven not to be the case, and fundamental equity and fairness and non-discrimination in access to basic human needs and services in health, in education, for instance, that requires legal protection and enhancement through the law.
Thank you very much. We'll move over to my left now with our next question.
Oh, my goodness. Louise, it's so difficult to follow your discussion. You're so eloquent and you spoke so well, and at this moment in time, I'm wondering why I even got up to the microphone. My heart is going right through my chest. But I'm going to try, because you seem so down to earth, so real, and I feel trust, and I just want to tell you, ask you a question. My name is Susan Holmes. I'm a whistleblower. I'm on the board of directors of Whistleblowing Canada, and our organization is devoted to making the lives of whistleblowers better, improving them, trying to assist them and help them with the moral injury when they come forward and report wrongdoing. And our organization research branch indicated that Canada is ranking 32nd in all the countries in the world in terms of whistleblowing protection. And I just wondered, from your vast experience, what you might say. Our organization will be watching tonight. We're trying to keep on going, keep on working with legislation that is so incredibly weak that it fails to support whistleblowers. And experts in the United States say in Canada, it just isn't worth it to come forward. And that really terrifies me, especially juxtaposed to your speech. And that's enough. I better quit while I'm ahead, if I'm ahead.
All right. Well, first of all, thank you very much for working on, I think, an important issue that is, I think, very complex. And I'm afraid I just don't know enough. I'm just not familiar enough with the current state of the Canadian legislation to offer any views on whether it's as inadequate as some seem to suggest, whether it's in a state of evolution. Honestly, I don't know. But I think that we, as a principle, we want to invest in offering a secure, protective environment for those who are in a position to expose severe shortcomings, whether it's in the public sector or in the private sector, of corruption or abuse of power. And so I think, like most people, would endorse the principle, but I really am sorry I can't help you on the details of it. The one thing I don't like to do is advance in environments in which I don't feel confident about my own views.
Thank you. Next question, again on my left-hand side.
Hello. First off, I just want to say thank you so much for everything that you have done in all of your roles and have been such a leader. When I graduated as a paralegal 4 years ago now, one of the first things that I did was look up into our legal atmosphere and pick out somebody who I could look up to. And for me, that was quite hard to do because what you're surrounded with is movies, TV, all of that stuff, which is fiction. And what I wanted to ask of you is, who, as you were growing up, did you look up to when you started into your career?
You know, they were not very many women in the legal profession ahead of me. I have nobody in my family was a lawyer or a judge. I fell into law really by default or by accident, just one of these lucky choices that I made. So I wish I could, there was no one that looked like me, which is maybe why I'm very sensitive now to the fact that there's still a lot of young people in this country trying to make professional choices, and there are not a lot of people that look like them ahead, you know, down the road. We have to be, when I spoke about everybody has a point of view, there's no universal point of view, not a lot of role model for, you know, young indigenous lawyers or people who are recent immigrants to this country. So I'm conscious of that, but I wish I could point to, no, I could never personalize the ideals that I saw in the legal profession.
Thank you very much. And just as Justice Bertha Wilson did, you are doing for many young women now.
Thank you. And the next question again on my left-hand side.
Yes, good day, Mr. Moore. My question is, and I'm sorry if you can't answer, if it's not really down your cup of tea, I don't know if anyone can. Now that the Neanderthals are calling the shots in Yugoslavia, what do you expect will happen in that poor country?
Well, you know, the former Yugoslavia has yes. been dismantled, as you know, through the horrors of warfare. And so its various components now, I think, have to reconstruct themselves, particularly, well, in all of the former republics of the former Yugoslavia, but I would say particularly maybe in Bosnia, have to reconstruct themselves into a pluralistic society, and that's not going to be easy when they have to emerge from an armed conflict. So all I could say is, and it's particularly, I think, not only in the interest, but in the obligations of Europeans to accompany that entire region into its, you know, peaceful, democratic future.
Well, I wish you good luck, and I do hope they can do it.
Yeah, I do.
Thank
too.
Thank you.
Bob, we have time for just one more question.
Okay.
Thank you. We wish we could have Madame Arbour for hours, but unfortunately, she has to go. She has other commitments she has to go to. So we'll take one more from our online audience. And the question comes from Sandra on YouTube. In consideration of your grandchildren's future, what role does Canada have in the global response to climate change?
Well, you know, I said again in my remarks that I think if there is, it's hard to think of a silver lining to the pandemic, but I think it has opened our eyes to immense global challenges. And it has made us realize that we are individually and collectively capable of bold, ambitious, daring changes in the way we live and the way we work. We've gone through, I think, a dress rehearsal of what we're going to be called upon to initiate in the years ahead if there's going to be something left for our grandchildren to live on this planet. So I think there should be virtually no limit to our ambitions. We should take comfort in the modest changes that we've been willing to make in this last year and a half to propel ourselves into even more bold and courageous choices that we're gonna have to make in the short, medium, and longer term. If we actually desire not only a better country, but a better planet altogether.
Well, certainly thanks to everyone for their very thoughtful questions. Madame Arbour will now be logging in to a private Zoom call to continue speaking to Canadian students from coast to coast to coast. But before you go, I would just like to thank you once again on behalf of the Confederation Center and, of course, everyone in attendance here for your very inspiring and thoughtful words tonight.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Veuillez vous lever pour le départ de son honneur, l'honorable Antoinette Perry. Please rise for the departure of the Honorable Antoinette Perry. Thank you for so much for joining us at the Symons Medal Lecture. We kindly ask that you remain in your seats for just a moment longer. To ensure social distance departure, please allow our team of ushers to direct each row when it is their time to exit the theater. We appreciate your understanding as we work together to ensure the safety of all our patrons. See you again soon. Merci de vous être joints à nous pour la médaille et causerie Symons. Nous vous invitons de rester à votre place un peu plus longtemps. Pour nous assurer de maintenir la distance sociale requise à la sortie, le personnel de salle avisera les spectateurs de chaque rangée du moment où ils pourront quitter le théâtre. Nous vous remercions de votre collaboration et nous espérons avoir le plaisir de vous revoir très bientôt.